NH Moshev Karu, and on behalf of the Schusterman Center for Judaic and Israel Studies, I would like to welcome you to what is going to be a fantastic evening. The title of this evening, as you can tell, is the Songs of Devotion and Desire, the Musical Heritage of Jewish Spain. We will start with a relatively short talk by our own professor, Luis Cortez from Modern Languages and Literature and Linguistics. Professor Cortez is a professor of Spanish. He studied in Madrid and got his degree from Berkeley. And his talk will be followed immediately by the musical program. So we are very, very fortunate to have tonight with us the internationally acclaimed mezzo-soprano Janice Meyerson. And you can read more about Luis, Professor Cortez, about Ms. Meyerson, and Lauren Richstone, who will accompany her on the piano. Lauren Richstone is an associate professor of opera and vocal coaching at the University of Oklahoma School of Music. In the interest of time, I will be brief. Let me just, there are a few thank yous in order. So first of all, thank you to the school, OU School of Music, who provided this recital hall. And we need to thank also our co-sponsors, the Oklahoma City Jewish Federation, the College of Fine Arts Dean's Circle, OU History Department, OU Department of Modern Languages, Literature, and Linguistics. And we also need to thank Lauren Richstone, who's really the driving force behind this evening, and he conceived this evening, and special thanks to him. And last but not least, thank you to Katie Hall, the Schusterman Center administrative assistants, who took care of all the logistical issues and made sure that the program runs smoothly. And of course, thank you to all of you for being here right after spring break. So enjoy the evening.
I want to thank those who invited me to give this brief presentation. It's a great honor to be here, and it's a great honor to talk about a subject that is very dear to me, and that is the subject of the Spanish Jews. There were so many things that, you know, that I thought about before coming, and so many things I wanted to say, but then Professor Shepker helped me out when he said, actually, the people are here to hear the music. And I think he's absolutely right about that, because I do know that in recent years, one of our presenters presented for, I'm told, almost an hour. I promise not to go that long. This will be very brief. And I apologize to anyone who finds this too simplistic, but my introduction, of course, must be for a general audience and not for an audience of specialists. With that in mind, I'll begin. When people in the U.S. think of Jews, they typically think of the Jews of Eastern Europe or the Ashkenazi Jews. This is naturally the case because most of the Jews who now live in this country are Ashkenazi Jews. It's a fact. Today, however, I'll be speaking about a different group, the Jews of Spain, or the Sephardic Jews. The word Sephardic is said to come from the Hebrew word Sepharad, which refers to Spain. Of course, as some of you know, those of you who study history, there is no nation called Spain when the Jews first arrived, right? That nation really comes together in the time of the Catholic kings in the late 15th century. In very simple terms, the Jews of Spain can be divided into two groups. The first group includes those who lived in Spain and were a part of the history of Spanish jewelry that lasted for over 1,000 years. The second group includes the descendants of the Jews expelled from Spain in 1492. All are Spanish Jews, but we can divide them up in very simple terms into these two groups. In other words, the second group, the Sephardic Jews I'll be talking about mostly, includes the descendants of the first group who have lived for centuries outside of Spain in what I'll call the Spanish diaspora. Many historians believe that the Jews first arrived on the Iberian Peninsula, the landmass where modern Spain is located, with the Romans in the time of the Roman occupation. Other scholars think that the Jews arrived during the time of the Visigoths, after the 5th century. This debate is of little importance for us at this moment. What we do know is that the Jews had a long, long history in the place we now call Spain. In fact, some of the Jews who lived there are considered among the most important cultural figures in the history of the Jewish people. I'll mention only three names at this time. First of all, the poet Judah Halevi, or in Spanish, Yehuda Halevi. He was one of the most important poets in all of Jewish history. Judah Halevi, who died in 1075, wrote most of his poetry in Hebrew. He certainly was, along with Solomon ibn Gavirol, one of the two greatest poets among the Spanish Jews. Secondly, I would mention the 13th century religious writer Moshe de Leon, the author slash compiler of the Zohar, or Book of Splendor, the most important book in the history of Jewish mysticism, or Kabbalah. No one knows with certainty how much of the Zohar was written by Moshe de Leon, but we do know that he was the great master who prepared a written version of traditional mystical teaching that had existed long before his time. Lastly, of the three I mentioned, I want to mention Moses Maimonides, the greatest of the medieval Jewish philosophers. Maimonides and his family left Cordoba in Spain when Maimonides was about 13. Before his death in 1204, Maimonides would write many of the most important works of Jewish religious and philosophical thought. It should be obvious by now that the Jewish communities in Spain included magnificent poets, philosophers, and mystics. Unfortunately, however, the history of the Jews in Spain is also a history of discrimination and intolerance. If one spends any time reading the laws that refer to the Jewish community in the great legal corpus, the Siete Partidas, prepared in the time of King Alfonso X, who died in 1284, it is clear that the Jews in Spain, in the parts of Spain under Christian rule, lived in separate communities and were always under the strict control of Christian rulers. One especially important date in the history of the Jews of Spain is 1391, a year in which pogroms swept across Spain. One devastating effect of those acts of persecution and violence was that many, many Jews left Spain that year. As some of you know, the formal expulsion of the Jews from Spain would come on August 2nd, 1492, same year that Columbus sails from Palos de la Frontera. In the months following that proclamation, it is believed that over 160,000 Jews left Spain. Many of these Jews went to nearby Portugal. It was close. It seemed like a good choice. They would arrive, but survive there for only a few years, and once again be forced to either convert to Christianity or leave. After leaving Spain and Portugal, the Spanish Jews, or now Sephardim, plural, settled in numerous communities, first in the Mediterranean region, and later in Northern Europe and the New World. There they sang their songs brought from Spain and sought to maintain their Spanish culture. In the diaspora, Hispanic Jews handed down their medieval Spanish past, customs, music, and language. One of the most interesting places where Sephardic traditions once flourished is a city in Greece now known as Thessalonica, or in Greek, Thessaloniki. That city, called by Sephardic Jews Salonika, was a part of the Ottoman Empire for hundreds of years. There, the Sephardic community built many synagogues and even had several different newspapers published in Ladino. In linguistic terms, Ladino is the most common name used to describe the Sephardic dialects of Judeo-Spanish. The Jewish community in Thessalonica was virtually wiped out by the Nazis during the Second World War. Now, in a city that once had a Jewish population of over 55,000, there are almost no Jews. In fact, years ago, I visited Thessaloniki and spent time there working in an archive looking at a book written by a famous rabbi, Moshe Alkosnino. And I asked the vice rector of the University of Aristotle, which is there at Thessaloniki, I said, is it true that many of the stones used to build this building, in fact, were taken from the Jewish cemetery, which no longer exists? He said, that's impossible. Actually, if you go there and you know what you're looking for, you can still see the inscriptions on many of the stones. The traditional songs characteristic of the Sephardic Jews were and still are to this day called in Ladino romances. In modern Spanish, modern Castilian, romances, or in Spain, romances. The lyrics of these songs recount the lives of Spanish Jewry and of Spanish history. Only a few written examples of musical scores have survived from the Spanish Middle Ages. However, in addition to the descriptions of Sephardic musical practice taken from medieval sources, the Sephardim oral heritage provides a guide to this immensely rich musical culture. The female voice is dominant in traditional Sephardic musical performance. Many of the topics featured in the songs are represented from a woman's point of view, since it was the woman, the mother, who would pass on Sephardic traditions to their daughters. The Sephardim maintained a dual repertoire. For sacred music, this was sung in Hebrew, which followed the Jewish liturgical calendar. For secular music, this is in general, not absolutely the case. For secular music, consisting of songs from their daily life, these songs were typically sung in the vernacular, and in the case of the Sephardic Jews, that would mean in Ladino. The revival of the Ladino song tradition of the music of the Sephardic Jews began in the early 20th century. Like so many other traditions, many European philologists, that is, scholars who study the history of languages and texts, wanted to find their roots in the Middle Ages. This was true of the German philologists, the French philologists, and the Spanish philologists as well. One of the scholars most responsible for the identification and collection of Ladino folk songs was the Spanish philologist Ramón Menéndez Pidal. Menéndez Pidal and his students found examples of Sephardic romances throughout the Mediterranean region and in the Americas, many nations in the Americas. Jewish folk songs composed in Ladino have been found in many parts of the U.S., including New Mexico, Texas, California, and New York. I mentioned New York last to make you smile, because many of us think of New York as the capital of the greater Jewish diaspora. But New York also has an important role in the history of the Sephardic community. The first Jews to settle in New York came from Recife in Brazil. They arrived in 1654. They had gone to Recife from Amsterdam when that part of Brazil was under Dutch rule. That small Sephardic community established the first synagogue in New Amsterdam, the place we now call New York City. No one knows where the first Jews arrived on U.S. soil. Those Jews who went to New Amsterdam were certainly among the first, but it's very possible and even likely that small groups of conversos, that is, Jews who had converted to Christianity, arrived in New Mexico in the late 16th century. That Spanish outpost was a place where some of those Jews practiced the faith of their fathers in secret. We know that some of these same religious rituals were practiced by Jews in secret for hundreds of years in Spain after the expulsion in 1492 and in other places. The crypto-Jews survived for centuries. The composers represented in this evening's program have adapted folk melodies from traditional Sephardic pieces and composed modern musical pieces to accompany the melody. You'll be, I think, surprised at how sophisticated some of these arrangements are, because the music, of course, is inspired by medieval themes, but it's very, very sophisticated and influenced, I think, in many instances by Spanish composers. I hope that you enjoy this evening's musical performance. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh.